Hi everybody, Robert Dunt, founder of ArtTop10.com, and I'm here with Sarah Jeffries at the Transcendence Exhibition, and she's just going to give us a bit more of an in-depth discussion of this piece. So, yeah. So remind me, what was its title?
It's called Small Windows of Marginal Opportunity.
All right, cool, I like it.
When I was visiting the Terps, I walked past this building that was just being built, and it's a black square of a building, and there's these irregular, you know, haphazard sort of windows dotted around, and it seems to be like the kind of current trend in architecture.
Okay. Yeah.
And for me, I'm trying to imagine what it's like being in that building where you only got like a window here and there.
Yeah.
And it kind of, in my mind, sort of referred to that kind of small window of marginal opportunity sort of
idea. Oh, that's quite interesting.
You know, that's where
so that's how you feel inside one of those sort of office buildings, one of those places.
Yeah. What it's like to be encased by a box that only has so many windows.
I think
you're being controlled slightly by the architecture.
It's actually really interesting. Yeah, well, you're not being controlled by those architecture in the sense that, like the sense of fact, we are inside these boxes all the time, aren't we?
Yeah, and these are very much neat and want you to feel like walls. And when you're looking at when a person's looking at, they're in between the two walls and taking part in being in the painting.
You do want to go in, and once you're inside, you get dragged into all these different little sections.
Yeah, I mean, some people sort of feel like they're mirrors. I've watched Twin Peaks, and it's kind of interesting how he sort of like has these bizarre sort of compositions sort of put together, and you know, obviously he uses the zigzaggy black and white lines for the floor.
Yeah.
And I started doing the black and white lines before I watched Twin Peaks originally.
Okay.
And I was like, oh my gosh. It looks like he's using it in a very similar way, like a very sort of surreal sort of like, but it's in a it's like it's in a room, so it's a floor, has a function. And this is a wall, so it has a function, and then the abstract black and white is kind of maybe feel like a cell, but also it's the black and white is like the dark and light, much like a sort of wrong and right together, so it's that kind of positive and negative together.
It's also desperately visual, isn't it, the black and white?
Yeah, it's kind of got that.
Optical sort of. It makes. I suppose, visually when you look at it, it puts you in a slightly kind of different mental framework already, doesn't it?
Right. Yeah. I mean, so I've been reading a lot about the participatory movement,
with
Claire Bishop's Artificial Health book, I've just started doing a PhD, and I'm really interested in looking at painting and how painting can inform participation projects. Participatory project. So she talks a lot about kind of community and collectivism, and how we need to remind ourselves that individualism isn't always a good thing, because it's very much, if you think about just yourself or like just solo shows or whatever, it's very much just that person that's important at that time, and everyone else is irrelevant almost. But and it's quite, as emerging artists, it's quite hard to kind of like get into the art world on your own.
So when you
collaborate, and then you get together and empower yourselves with collective, more possibilities could happen, and more new ideas could happen.
Yeah, it's more exciting.
There's only a limit to like where you are in your mind, sort of thing. So, I mean, and this side is it feels more individual, and that side feels more collective.
Yeah, look, that actually got quite different atmospheres each side. This one for me has more like sort of more weird dreams with like the horn and the. I like the man. He's got the little black and white stripes on his shirt.
Right.
Well. Yeah, that's really cool. Is there a sort of look, because you've got the little trompe l'oeil sort of effects. Is there another sort of art history sort of joke coming in?
I mean, with my work, it's always sort of got that. I want to make an illusion.
Yeah.
Like it's coming out of the viewer, it really exists in front of you.
Almost. Oh, I see this one. I do quite like the sense that you've got the black and white stripes that starts getting you into this otherworldly sensation. And then the other things on top of the black and white stripes sort of accentuated the unreality of them.
Yeah, I mean, because it's like maybe three dimensions. Like, that's outside, this is between you and your inside. So possibly we're inside, literally.
Oh, yeah, because that's quite nice,
like,
thought,
it's the wall,
yeah.
And that's the outside. So
yeah, I feel more. It's because that one seems to come out of me. This one goes behind. But yeah, you do feel inside. When you stand in here, you do feel inside something.
Yeah. So I mean, that's kind of participatory as well. You know, it's kind of got that feel to it. And when Claire Bishop talks about how painting can never be like not about individual authorship. I feel and the painting sculpture is always, you know, like an item of capitalism, and it doesn't do anything for the community. It's like, I don't agree with that.
I don't agree with that.
Yeah. Because when you look at a painting, it might make you think in a different way, and therefore that's, you're partaking in a piece of art that is changing our attitude, possibly to a certain thing that we experience. So, you know, we are partaking in art.
What did she say? It doesn't do anything.
So it doesn't. She's saying that it's just an object of the capital, it's just an object of the art market. It's a consumer object, and it's about individual authorship. She's saying that it's kind of like we need to get away from that, but yet she's missing the point of what art does to a person when they look at it.
And actually, when you talk about getting into galleries and showing your work, you already are. It's smaller than potentially the galleries you're thinking of, but it's, you know, it's democratic and it's there and the viewers can see it.
Yeah, and you know, the fact this is a group show as well, and they're all getting together in the art community, and some public are coming into the preview, and some people, you know, public are visiting the show. It's kind of, this is a hub for people getting together outside of the harsh world, you know, like, so we are being collective because we're in a group show and we're all like helping out each other.
Yeah, I mean, I think those things kind of exist all at once in the same time, you know, this authorship and this kind of capitalism, it can also be inclusive and, you know, and generous for a viewer.
Just need to make it, you know, a softer sort of thing and more inclusive.
I suppose it can be pointed in a particular way, can't it? From show to show.
Yeah.
This article's on colour reminds me of something that Seamus Heaney wrote, where he was saying a poem, you never stop the tank.
Who is this?
Seamus Heaney, like the poet, Irish poet, was writing how a poem could never stop a tank. But the odd thing was, in one hand, he seemed to be saying the poem could never stop a tank, and then he was saying that our poetry would never be able to change our ideals. So her comment, in a way, to me, sounds almost like it's a bit of a wind up.
Yeah.
It's almost sort of.
Like a
daring that to be a reality.
Right.
Yeah. Anyway, let's go down and see your pictures.
Yeah. I mean, I suppose even her doing that, it's kind of like making us just consider
that. Well, it's making us consider how.
So it's an important
place, really. It is important. I mean, it's emotional.
If anything, it's going to make us less egotistical, possibly. If we think about participatory art, you know, less about the individual, more about kind of broadening horizons and being collective, you know, and then,
yeah.
So that could be a good byproduct of the whole thing.
I think it's quite a dangerous comment. If I'm getting right what she said, she's saying any painting is primarily or essentially only commercial product.
Yeah.
Is what she's saying.
And it's kind of this kind of elitist sort of thing, which is, you know,
how
an object in a gilt frame, which is, you know, capitalist investment, and actually, no, she's talking about, you know, one diametrically opposed pole, and everything exists between those poles. It's kind of generous kind of thing, you know, and it's a light switch or a mark on a wall being something that you would consider if it had a gilt frame around it. Would you consider it? I forget who you said, under it's only an atmosphere of theory that differentiates art objects from other things. At least someone very clever, but I think it's right.
Well, it's a cool comment.
Because you can consider other things as art objects, and it can be democratic.
Art can change our attitude and can influence our culture, and that is participatory, isn't it?
It is.
Oh yeah, absolutely. It changes the way you look at the world.
Yeah.
But yeah, go on with the crazy part.
This is me trying to subvert the sort of format and system, but then at the same time, you know, it's kind of bubble. So possibly ignorant bubble. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You can live in your own bubble, and you choose
to surround yourself. That's quite cool, yeah.
Someone's isolated themselves possibly one time in the history of this home, you know, and they're just like, I've had enough of society.
I'm just going to live in my bubble.
This is why I'm kind of like drawn by this image. I've made sort of like a drama happen with this. I mean, this sky is just, I made it out of my mind, but with the idea of the screen by Monk.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's kind of like, it just kind of went, it was grey and it got darker, and I thought, I need darker.
So all right, so it got darker and darker and darker in the sky.
It's almost like Martin doing his systematic painting and kind of going, how far do I go? And I'm like, oh my god, it's getting darker.
It sounds like the sun is setting as you imagine.
The sun's going, and it's an artificial sun.
Yeah,
it's
kind of the weird light.
And illuminating in certain areas of the painting. I thought it was quite, in a way, it's kind of the way that this occurred. It sort of feels like these are figurative beings, you know, and that only some are illuminated.
Yeah.
Like these ones, they decided that these ones are illuminated and these ones aren't.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking, you know, like, in possibly like that collectivism.
Yeah.
We're only allowing these people to be in our.
Are they the only ones who are allowed?
If they can be in the circle, the rest of them not.
The rest of them not.
You know. And this black and white sort of controlling sort of territory, sort of boundaries. Sort of thing. Yeah, it's quite interesting. And I was thinking of Brexit and how we're all like, oh my god, are we in the club or we're not going to be in the club? And then, like, you know, what happens if we're not? You know, where are we going? You know?
Where are we going?
And then, where's it all going to end? You know, and I feel like that's sort of like the sort of angst, I suppose.
Yeah, angst. But it also sets up that kind of surreal contingent of your sense. And also, it's a flexible point, it's kind of it's. Kind of a stupid point. If I remember the one, you're a Star Destroyer in Star Wars coming towards me. Like a massive thing moving towards you.
The whole painting or the
just the triangle there.
The triangle, yeah.
But,
So, you know, and with the sort of shape of it, it's kind of saying that the painting is a sculpture.
Yeah, no. And I do like the strong colours for the special isolated plants.
Special ones.
The special ones, yeah. Yeah, it's funny, would you rather be one of the special ones or one of the old?
In our political climate.
I feel
a little bit more like this.
Yeah, that's where we're all huddled together. Yeah.
And you know, with the art world, it sort of feels like that as well. You know,
Totally.
Like only you are allowed, and the rest of you are not allowed to be in the group of success.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it does feel like that. But then maybe we're not really the art world, a weird, some of it is just a weird constructed commercial thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think the art world, when you talk about it, should be changed into art worlds.
Art worlds.
We're actually, you are existing in the art world.
Yeah.
Well,
you're just not one of.
But the way it's set up, it makes people
Totally. I mean, if you watch the other videos I did with Graham Crowley, he was saying that money has allowed the art market to dominate the language of the art world.
Yeah.
So there's no language left for us to use because it's all being taken by the big commercial
companies. So it's confronting that very thing.
Well, I think so. Yeah.
So it's kind of maybe she's doing a service to the, you know, to just us. As painters or sculptors or whatever, she is doing a service to that. So that means, you know, that we're all like just, you know, waste of the capital.
She's almost saying the same thing. She's almost saying, come up with a language that explains to me why a painting is not, at some point, commercial commodity.
Yeah.
And it's hard to justify. It's never.
Yeah, I suppose the thing is that she doesn't want she wants to close the gap between authorship and spectatorship.
Mm-hmm.
So like she's closing the gap, there's always going to be the audience. You can't have everyone in the world as your audience, even when the images we produce, there's going to be an audience looking at the image of the participation project.
You see, but that's quite interesting, isn't it? So in a way, you're saying the saving grace to the dominance of the art market's language is audience, is the people who see the stuff, the people who see the work. They're the thing that will negate the language dominance.
Well, it's this, I suppose it's like that if it's democratic art, people feel included. Mm. And when it's not democratic, it's slightly alienating, possibly. Mm. And if we can reduce the alienation, then we can all participate a bit more in the art.
Well, it's quite, because that's the way I was set up art to attend, because I knew some people who had, you know, uber-educated PhD backgrounds, not in art, subjects. And some people who hadn't had such incredible educations, and they both said to me exactly the same thing. They said, "Look at the painting, and I feel really intimidated.
Yeah.
I don't know what I'm meant to say about it."
Interesting. Yeah. And I had the discussion on Facebook about spectator versus audience, and a lot of people saying, "I feel unimportant when I'm looking at art." And yes, I'm important.
They feel unimportant.
I'm not important.
Oh, I'm not important.
It's for the viewer, isn't it? You make paintings for the viewer.
Absolutely.
I mean, it comes
staggering to me that a painting could do that to someone and make someone feel so at a loss.
Yeah, exactly.
Which I think almost feeds into this sort of apex, the apex predators of art, of the art world, that kind of, you know, feel like they have all this language, this capital, that they're dishing it out, and that that is, you know, somehow exclusive
and almost elitist. Buy one of those expensive things you're allowed to
go to the club
where you know everyone understands you and you've got it on your wallet.
Where you're given a printed out sheet telling you what the painting means.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think it was Duchamp, just to do another quote for you, that said that, you know, artworks will end up being, the sort of description of artworks will end up being more important, bigger than the artworks themselves.
Well,
which kind of has happened.
Yeah.
Is that the current?
But I mean, you know, there's loads of people that do get a lot out of painting, and it's empathetic.
Mm.
You know, that empathy that we don't have a lot of in our society, a very harsh line society, it seems. There's not a lot of empathy for the other person. When I look at paintings, the ones that really get me, the ones that kind of give me solace, give me empathy, that I can kind of huddle up with emotionally, So that's, and I think that's just one of the things that, painting does, isn't it?
Yeah, I was talking to a guy, a journalist the other day, and he said that when he went around by the National Gallery or something, he'd choose one painting, and he'd look at that for quite a long time, and he'd take away whatever he could to sort of help him through the day. But I mean,
it's like music as well. I mean, music is dysfunctional without the listener.
Absolutely.
And painting is dysfunctional without the viewer. We need both, don't we? So
totally. I don't know, it's a bit pretentious, but I actually think a painting is only finished when it's looked at by other people. And then, and it's the time you spend with it, and it's slightly pointless spending 30 seconds in the gallery. You actually need it and look at it. And then after you spend, I find days looking at stuff, you suddenly think this little bush becomes like a friend.
Yeah.
And that little community here or the relationship, and that's almost, they're almost finally made in the viewer's mind when they find these little roots through them, these little homes.
Yeah. And then, Claire Bishop thinks that that you're describing is just entertainment. So therefore you're passive and being stunned by the entertainment. Right. So, I don't really agree that
not at all.
Because it's more emotional, it's more soul fulfilling.
Yeah,
absolutely. It's more kind of, there's like a tactile, there's, I much prefer to look at a painting in flesh than to look at an image.
Unless,
I'm with the painting. It's doing so many more different things, the shine of it, the depth of the colour.
But actually, looking in real life, it's quite an imaginative, creative experience.
If it's thought provoking.
Yeah, if it works.
It's another case in point for the viewer becoming, part of the author of the narrative of the work.
Because
then it completes. Because I've always sort of thought that when my paintings, when I finish a painting, it's kind of dead because I'm and then it's no longer being activated. And then, so when I was showing this painting in this show, I put it up and it was like really strange because it was a part of something else.
Yeah. Exactly. You know, it's alive, then, isn't it?
Yeah. Or it then has the potential to be activated by the season.
Very cool. Well, the paintings have got us into many good discussions.
Yes. So, debate.
Yeah, debate. Anyway, okay guys, well, comment at the bottom. Tell us what you think about the discussions. And, anyway, thank you very much for watching us, Emma.
Thank
you very
much
for chatting with us, Bruce. Okay.
Thanks.
Cheerio. Bye. Bomb buckler.